All right, guys. Well, I don't know what's going on with my game. I may need to re-download this, but just as an FYI, this game crashed the first time I tried to record it. So this battle. So we're gonna fast forward past the troop deployment phase. Hopefully, it works this time. I'm kind of getting sick and tired of this game constantly crashing on me. Here we go. Here we go, guys. Welcome to our first battle in our series on the unification of Hawaii, the Battle of Kepaniwai. If you guys are unfamiliar with this battle, there's a lot of background to delve into here because it is a really cool and really fascinating period of history that's often forgotten because it is just essentially a series of islands in the middle of the ocean. But it says a lot about what's happening in the world at the time of this battle. So, if you're unfamiliar with the geography of the state, the U.S. state of Hawaii, the state is named after the largest of the islands. Most people refer to it as the Big Island, but it's the easternmost island, the largest, is called Hawaii, and all the other ones have different names. But on the island of Hawaii, in the late 1700s, the king of that particular island dies and leaves the throne not to either of his two sons, but to his nephew, who happens to be the head priest of the kingdom. Now, that head priest was actually not interested in becoming king. He wanted to maintain his responsibilities as head priest instead. But his two cousins, who were the sons of the previous king, were furious that neither of them were named heir to the kingdom. So one of them goes and burns down the sacred grove. And that's essentially like the most holy place on the whole island. So think of it like the Vatican in Rome for Hawaiian religion. So Kamehameha, the head priest, is so angry at this that he accepts the title of king. He accepts his inheritance to the throne and wages a war of revenge against his two cousins for burning the sacred grove. He defeats his two cousins, but recognizes the eyes of European colonists are now on Hawaii and the islands and the rest of the chain as a potential new colony, particularly for Britain and Spain. So Kamehameha's first task is to find a way to prevent European colonization and conquest. He does this by realizing the only way to prevent this is to unify all of the islands of the chain under a single unified throne. So he begins a campaign to annex the other islands of the Hawaiian island chain. Now here in Kepaniwai, Kamehameha sends his first major military invasion of another island. Here on Maui, which is the largest, the next island west of Maui, or of Hawaii, of sizable importance. So the battle turns out to be a draw, a stalemate, because the native Mauians turn out to be really genius at utilizing the terrain and hit-and-run tactics against Kamehameha's forces. Now, Kamehameha, in order to make any ability, anything close to being able to annex the other islands, requires sophisticated weapons technology that he has to buy from British colonists at the Vancouver colony on the border of present-day Washington and Oregon. Which, side note, you guys can visit today for Vancouver, in Vancouver, Washington. So what he does is he buys a couple cannons from the British colonists over at Fort Washington and launches his invasion of Maui. He also gains a couple of European military advisors to advise him for his campaign. But unfortunately, European tactics are no match for the geography of the Hawaiian Islands, which is something that the Europeans have never yet had to deal with on this scale. They have, of course, started colonizing the Caribbean, but by the time they really started launching any major military endeavors, they were launching it against fellow Europeans more than the indigenous Taino. But here in the Hawaiian Islands, the indigenous people are still pretty numerous in size and are the main opposition group to Kamehameha's invasions. So the European tacticians working for Kamehameha aren't really accustomed to the warfare style of the native Hawaiians. So what this does is it forces Kamehameha to adapt a new strategy for annexation, a combination of military tactics and political maneuvers, particularly in politically driven marriages with local royal families. So Kamehameha would end up marrying multiple wives throughout his campaign to solidify his right to rule the islands, particularly in siring heirs who could be essentially the heirs to the thrones of both the larger kingdom of the unified islands as well as the kings of the individual islands. Now you're probably noticing we're using Native American factions in this game. Unfortunately, there's no like oceanic factions, there's no Tahitians or Hawaiians or Maori forces that you can play as in this game, so this is about as close as we can get to Native Hawaiians. Oh man, that guy just got a sick kill. Over on my left, I'm trying to send my bowman to go take out the Hawaiian artillery, but they are sending one of their bodyguard units to intercept my boys. The leaders of this battle, by the way, for Hawaii, they're Kamehameha the Great or Kamehameha the First, and Keiku Haupio. For Maui, we have Kalani Kapule. Both armies have about 1,200 troops, so this is a full scale. Each soldier you see here represents about one that would have been at the historical battle. Now, if you're wondering what Kamehameha had to sell in order to get those cannons, unfortunately, in order to prevent colonization, he had to allow selective colonization. And what I mean by that is he sold parcels of land on the island of Hawaii to British prospectors in exchange for European-style weapons, first with cannons, and then later at the Battle of Nuuanu, we'll see some European-style muskets as well. And this caused a problem later on in his campaign, I believe after Nuuanu, when he was preparing for his invasion of Kauai. I think that's the right timeline. I might be wrong about the timing on that, but he faced a rebellion by his own lords on the island of Hawaii in response to the British prospectors that began moving in to those land parcels. Because they were, I believe, bringing livestock, particularly cattle. I might be wrong about the specific livestock, but they were bringing livestock to the island, which, if you know anything about livestock farming before the Industrial Revolution, which, how wouldn't you? You probably don't. You probably don't. It takes a lot of wind. I mean, if you've ever seen, like, a documentary on climate change, you probably know how much land cattle need for free-range grazing. So those prospectors started to move beyond the land that was allotted to them in the same way that they did the exact same thing in Virginia with Jamestown. They just started slowly expanding beyond what they were allowed to do through their official treaties with the indigenous people. And Kamehameha's lords of the island of Hawaii were furious about this. But Kamehameha realized he couldn't unify the islands without European help. So he had to fight his own lords, expand the territory allowable for European settlers to live on the islands, and he started selling land on Maui as well, and I believe on Oahu as well, which would cause a lot of internal problems in the kingdom for him, but would allow him to get the weapons he would need to continue his campaign. So it's an unfortunate side effect. To prevent colonization, Kamehameha accidentally caused the colonization of Hawaii. Now we are overrunning the main bulk of the Hawaiian Islanders. Over here, the bodyguard, or one of the bodyguard units, is doing a good job of holding against our bowmen and preventing us from getting to those cannons. But we're going to send some of our kind of more melee infantry over there to take out those cannons. Send the rest of our melee infantry to take out this bodyguard unit. Help our archers out. Now, if you ever go to Maui, you can visit the battlefield today. It's in the Iao Valley. It's a state historic park, I believe. Kamehameha, for you geography boys and persons of other genders, Kamehameha landed his forces about where the town of Kahului is now, which is where the airport is located on Hawaii, or on Maui. Marched his troops up through the current town of Wailuku, which is where I lived when I lived on Maui, into the Iao Valley, where he battled the local Maui warriors in the Battle of Kepaniwai. You can visit the site of the battle today. There's some really cool hiking in that area if you get the chance. It's one of the places I always recommend to people when they are visiting Maui. Alright, we're about to rout this group of bodyguards. Now, a lot of our archers are routing, but they will return to the fight. We're going to use them to fend off some of these archers harassing our own bodyguard unit. And here we go, sending our warriors to go take out these cannons. Hopefully they don't switch to canister shot here. Oh, oh. I think they're gonna get a shot off. How did you miss? We were 3 feet in front of you. Oh, they're still missing. Oh man, I am getting lucky. All right, we are routing that artillery unit, so we're just waiting on the archers now. And they actually routed my own bodyguard unit. And there we go, we just shattered the last bodyguard unit from the Hawaiians. By the way, the music we're listening to, we've got some folk music from across Polynesia. I didn't want to look specifically for Hawaii because you get a lot of ukulele. And fun fact, if you guys are into like world folk music and music history, The ukulele is actually a Portuguese instrument. I learned this when I was learning ukulele living in Maui. So Portuguese sailors brought the ukulele to Hawaii. The Portuguese name for it, I don't remember what their name is, but they brought it to Hawaii. I believe it was like whaling ships used to use the Hawaiian Islands as a stop, like a rest stop to refill food, water. And the Portuguese, I'm not sure if it was like an official trade or anything, but essentially exported the instrument to Hawaii, and the indigenous Hawaiians started playing it, and it kind of included it into their music scene, and it eventually became a staple of what we think of Hawaiian folk music today. But it's not a Polynesian instrument. It's an instrument that comes from Portugal. So I wanted to find some Polynesian music that did not include any ukuleles, and I had to go outside of Hawaii folk music to find it. It looks like we are starting to hit these bowmen pretty well. We're pulling our line infantry out of there because unfortunately, the only way to get rid of these archers is with our own archers. But yeah, it's kind of a fun thing. A lot of, you know, obviously ukulele is kind of like a quote-unquote traditional instrument of Hawaii today. But the thing is, tradition today was new 100 years ago. So, like in anthropology, we try not to use the word tradition or traditional because it's so relative. You know, like I said, something that's traditional today was new 100 years ago or 200 years ago, however long ago it was. It was new at some point. And so tradition is kind of like a lazy word to just excuse a facet of a culture's history. Like a good example is like the horse is part of traditional Lakota warfare, but the horse didn't enter Native American warfare tactics until the arrival of the Spanish, so how traditional can it be? So, yeah. But I digress. I'm getting off topic here. What's not off topic is our Patreon page. Get excited. We have a Patreon. You can head to the link in the video description below. Shout out to our subscribers, the Todd McCarcus, Bob Wilson, Locagos, Melissa Carter, Neil Christie, here as the battle winds down. This battle is just about over, guys. If you like this battle, go ahead and hit the like button. If you want to see more battles from 18th century Oceania, whether that's Hawaii or New Zealand, Australia, let me know in the comments below which battles you'd like to see. I'll try to find how to do them. There's not a lot of info on a lot of those battles, but I will do it if you guys want to see it. But yeah, and if you guys want to stay up to date on all of our battle reenactments, hit that subscribe button. I've got a new, like, fun way of trying to get subscribers up. You guys are going to be helping me earn ranks by doing these battles. So right now, I think I'm at 28 subscribers as of recording this battle. So I'm at the rank of a sergeant, which leads a squadron. If you guys can get me to 30 subscribers, I will be upgraded to the rank of lieutenant, which leads a platoon. And once we get to 100, you'll help me get to the rank of captain, which leads company. So, guys, I'd love it if you hit the subscribe button. You're going to help me earn rank in our fictional military here on my channel. And I look forward to eventually becoming your 5-star general in the future as we level up. But, guys, thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the next battlefield.